guys. So every now and again, I ask friends and family if there's something about my life in Rwanda that they're curious about, they'd like to know about. And this time around, I've had a few requests to cover malaria. So what it's like living in a malaria zone. This is also a question that comes up a lot in forums, expat forums. People are coming here on holiday, they're moving here, especially with their family, and they're concerned or they're curious, they want to know, you know, how dangerous it is, and what people here do to avoid it. So one of my friends came up with this list of questions, which I thought was quite comprehensive. Malaria, do you get it? How bad is it? Do you acquire some local immunity after a while? And are you always taking medication? So I thought that was probably a good starting point. I've got a cup of tea here and I'm going to talk you through it. Cheers. So I think most people are aware that malaria is a disease that is spread by mosquitoes, but not everybody's too sure quite how the mechanics of that work. So what tends to happen is a mosquito will feed on somebody who's got malaria. It'll then carry that malaria with it and pass it on to anybody else that it bites. So technically speaking, most people don't think of malaria as being a particularly contagious disease because you can't pass it on just by touching somebody, or I don't think you can pass it on even by kissing somebody. But often you'll find that if somebody in a family gets it, a lot of other people in the family come down with it, because all it takes is that one mosquito in the same household to bite several people, and it's passing it on within a family unit or within anybody within a close proximity. So in that respect, it is kind of contagious. So what happens is you get bitten by an infected mosquito and that passes on the parasite into your bloodstream. Now, from that point, it gets a bit complicated. There is an entire chart that explains the life cycle of malaria, and it's heavy reading. But long story short, it makes its way through your blood to your liver, and then it goes through a sort of a maturing stage. And then it releases itself and it burrows into your blood cells, where it starts to hatch. Complicated, but what most people associate with malaria is when you get the shivers and the fevers. And that stage of getting malaria is when it's hatching out of your blood cells. So you're shivering and you're shaking and you're sweating, you've got fever, because your blood cells are kind of exploding inside your veins, and it's your body trying to cope with all of these broken bits of blood cell and trying to clean it out of your body and process that problem. So it's an unpleasant disease, and you can have malaria for quite a while and not know it, and then you only know it when it starts to reach that sort of matured stage where it affects your blood cells. So you've got different types or different strains of malaria in different countries around the world. And they all begin with the parasitic genus Plasmodium, which is usually shortened to just P. So you've got P. malariae, P. vivax, P. ovale, P. nolsi. And then you've got a really nasty strain called P. falciparum. And unfortunately, Plasmodium falciparum is the one that we've got here in Rwanda and across huge swathes of Africa. And that is the one that is generally responsible for a high death toll. Now, although they've all got different names, all of these strands of malaria are basically the same problem. They're all transported by mosquitoes, they all enter your bloodstream, they all hatch into your blood, they cause fevers, they cause shivers. The difference tends to be the severity of the symptoms that you experience, and also the cycle at which you experience them. So what tends to happen is after the shivers and the sweating is there'll be a period of calm where you just return to normal. And if you don't treat it, I mean, you might think it's gone away, but it hasn't, and it's just going back into its sort of hatching stage again. And then later down the line, you'll suddenly get the fevers and the chills and it'll kick off again. And different strands of malaria have a different length of time in the cycle. So with falciparum, it's pretty quick acting. You are likely to know about it within about 2 weeks of having been bitten, which is why they say if you're taking prophylaxis, keep taking that for 2 weeks after you get home. And you know, that gives you just a little bit of extra protection if there's any chance that you might be carrying anything. But after 2 weeks, if you haven't got it, you're pretty much safe. So talking about prophylaxis, what are your options and should you take them? Anything I go on to say here is not medical advice. I am not a doctor. I am just somebody who's lived in a malarial zone for many years, and I've kind of watched how different people cope with things, and I know how I cope with things. So I'm just talking very much from a non-medical personal perspective here. When I first came out here as a volunteer in 2007, I spent 2 years from 2007 till the end of 2009. I travelled the entire country. I went to rural areas. I was in city areas. I went into people's houses. I stayed by the lakes. I stayed in the forests. And during those 2 years in country, never got malaria, which was quite interesting because you can't predict it. Some people will stay here for years and years and years. I knew somebody who was here for 9 years and never got it. And I knew somebody else who came to visit their parents here, got off the plane, and within a couple of weeks they were flat out with it. So you cannot predict it, you really can't. Now, there used to be three main options for falciparum prophylaxis. Again, I'm really only talking about for P. falciparum. We do have other strains of malaria here, but generally speaking, falciparum is the one that you want to be afraid of, and that's the one that most of the prophylaxis are sort of geared towards preventing. I think they also do provide cover for the other forms. Now, when we talk about malarial prophylaxis, a lot of people immediately think about gin and tonic. Because it's quite widely known that during colonial rule in India, a lot of people were drinking a lot of gin and tonic because there's quinine in tonic. That's what gives it the bitter flavour. And the belief was that if you drank enough quinine, it would make you resistant to malaria. Now, there is some truth in that. You know, for a very, very long time, it's been known that quinine prevents malaria, but only certain types of malaria, and unfortunately falciparum isn't one of them. It's a quinine resistant strand of malaria, so unfortunately gin and tonic ain't going to help you. A lot of people swear by Marmite, that if you eat Marmite you're not going to get it. I think you might have more luck like smearing Marmite on your sort of body and ankles at night than actually eating it. I don't think that's been scientifically proven, but there are three prophylaxis that were traditionally offered. One of them is no longer available for a very good reason. It was called mefloquin, or larium was the other name it was sold under. And it used to be touted as a really good one because you only had to take one pill once a week, whereas with everything else you have to take one pill every day. So for idiots like me who don't often remember to do things or are not very good at routine, it seemed like a good idea. You know, one pill once a week, you're going to be fine. Unfortunately, it had a lot of side effects, and one of the side effects that was actually listed on the packaging was suicide. And I don't mean to laugh at suicide, but the fact that it was listed as a side effect made people a little bit nervous. It's like, oh, hi, James, how are you doing? Hi, Marion, I'm great, how are you? Yeah, I'm good. James, do you maybe want to put the knife down? You appear to be bleeding out there. Oh, yeah, it's just the side effects of my medication. Like, seriously? And because of this and a host of other reasons, like hallucinations, it was banned even by the British Army. So there are a lot of people who were taking larium when I arrived in 2007, and there were a lot of people who were taking it and experiencing no side effects at all. It is possible to take it and not have side effects, but there were people who were experiencing side effects. So one of my colleagues claimed that she was seeing dead people, which in a country that had recently experienced a genocide was not reassuring. And another friend actually physically went down to her local doctor because she was convinced that there were black worms in her veins. So, when you're coming out to a foreign country, if you're coming here to work or just for a holiday, there are a lot of things to take in and a lot of adjustments to make, a lot of cultural differences to kind of get your head around and come to terms with. And, you know, you don't really want to add talking to furniture to that list of things that you've got to cope with. So yeah, I wouldn't touch that with a 10-foot barge pole. I did try it once for 1 week. It woke me up on the dot at exactly the same time every morning. It was something like 4:36 or something, I can't remember. Every single morning on the dot, and I did not feel good. So I tried it for 1 week and I thought, no. I was curious, you know, you've got to try things if you're curious, but I would not recommend that or touch it. And thankfully it has now been banned by most sensible authorities. Okay, so that gives you a couple of other options. The one that I did take for the first year that I was in country is called doxycycline. And doxycycline is just a sort of an antibiotic. I think it's prescribed for acne in teenagers. And it has some advantages. Doxycycline not only protects you against malaria, it also protects you against anthrax and bubonic plague. So that's always an option. That's good to know. But at the same point, it does also have its own side effects. Is often people feel that they experience an acidy tummy, so a bit of heartburn there. And also it makes you super sensitive to sunlight, so you burn much quicker, which, as you can imagine, being on the equator is not particularly helpful. But fewer side effects and also very cheap. So the third one is called Malarone. Now Malarone has the least side effects of any of them, or at least it tends to affect the fewest number of people with any form of side effect. But the problem is that it is much more expensive in comparison to something like Doxy, which is dirt cheap. So certainly when I was a volunteer, I don't think it had been available for that many years by the time I came out, but nobody I knew was on it just because it was so expensive. And like doxycycline, you had to take it every day. So just nobody took it. But the one time that I did take it is I spent Christmas in Sierra Leone with a friend, needed to get out of town. So we headed over there for Christmas, and my friend was from Sierra Leone and she took it. So I thought, if she's from there and she's taking a prophylaxis, I'm going to do the same. And I took Malarone whilst I was there, experienced no side effects at all. Yeah, so it's a good option. If you are just going for a couple of weeks, that is the one that most people opt for. And there might be some other options now. Those are the three that I'm aware of and that have traditionally always been taken here. Go and talk to your health clinic professional. Go and ask them. There might be something else on the market at the moment. Now, I do know about 5 months ago, there was a lot in the news about a malarial vaccine for Falciparum. Just to explain that one, that is not for holidaymakers or travellers. It needs to be administered to children, and they need about 4 doses in childhood to get that kind of protection. So it's not something like rabies or yellow fever that you can just pop down to your health clinic, get a jab and you're okay. Maybe in the future, we don't know, and hopefully. The problem with malaria is that genetically it mutates really quickly. So the reason it's taken such a long time to get a vaccine, from what I understand, is because it's a bit like the common cold. The same reason that you don't have a vaccine against that is because every time you've developed a vaccine for it, it mutates and changes again, and then the vaccine isn't so effective. But I think they've managed to nail down malaria now, and it's brilliant because they're now going into this mass trial and production of this vaccine, which they're giving to children. Generally speaking, if you are a healthy, well-fed Mzungu, a healthy, well-fed person with access to decent medical care, you don't need to worry so much. You are likely to be well taken care of. But I will go into this a bit more in a minute. But really what I'm saying is that there are prophylaxis. If you're going on holiday for, you know, a couple of months, a couple of weeks, take one. It is a good idea to do so. Right, having said that and moving on to Alex's next question about, are you always taking medication? Having just told you that if you're coming here for a few weeks or a few months, take your prophylaxis. If you're moving here long term, and by long term I mean more than a year or two, it is a fact that pretty much no long-term expats take prophylaxis. It's not something we say proudly. You say, we're immune to this. We're not. But over a long-term period, that you've got to weigh up the sort of side effects and quality of life versus, you know, the downside of getting malaria. And it's something that you've got to decide for yourself. Nobody can tell you what to do, but most people, the majority of long-term expats, don't take anything. I don't think I know anybody who is taking anything at the moment, who has been here for several years. Because like I say, you know, doxy is the cheapest. That gives you sunburn and acidy tummy. Malaron is bloody expensive long term. So we just don't. And so what tends to happen for long term expats like myself is the trade off for not having to take something every day is that occasionally we get malaria. And it's not fun and it's not pleasant, but overall it's rare to get it. And when you do, you tend to get over it pretty quickly. Because like I said, most of us expats, we're well fed, we're pretty healthy, and we have access to medical care. And it's easier for us to get treatment for malaria because we are in a country where malaria is exceedingly common. Whereas it would be very difficult if we got back to the UK and came down with malaria, because in the UK it is a tropical disease and your local GP is not used to encountering it. And you know, it's not like you can just pop down to your local GP and say, I've got a bit of a sprained ankle and I think I've got malaria, you know, can you just write me a prescription for some pills? Whereas here, that's exactly what happens. You just go down your local clinic, you say, yeah, I think I've got malaria. They can tell you within 1 hour if you have, most of the time. And then what they do is they write you a prescription for something called Coartem. Now, Coartem is a miracle drug. It was invented, I think, sometime in the 1990s, or at least it went into production in the 1990s, but it's been known about for a long, 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 long time in China, because Coartem is made up of a couple of drugs, lumefantrine and artemisinin, or artemether. And artemether comes from a plant, artemisinin, which is grown throughout China. And it is basically sweet mugwort or wormwood. It is a herbal plant that has the incredible capability not just to help people to recover from malaria, but to kill the virus dead. And that is a phenomenal step forward in modern medicine. Because one of the big problems with malaria and the way that it often killed people was you probably survive the first round fine, you know, but like I said, it cycles. So you sweat, you shiver, you fever, you go back round to feeling normal again, and then it would hit you again, and then it would hit you again, and again, and again, and again. And the problem is that each time that it hits you, you're losing blood. Your blood cells are breaking apart, you're losing oxygen in your blood system. It's a real nasty way to go. But the moment that people realized what Coartem could do, it was a party in the streets, because it meant that you got the shivers, the shakes, you took the Coartem, which is usually a 3-day course of pills, and you're done. It's done. It's gone. until the next time you get it. So yeah, I think that was a game changer, and I think it's allowed a lot more people to come and live and work in malarial zones, especially Falciparum zones, because you can recover, and you can recover pretty quickly most of the time. So do I always take medication? No, I don't take any medication unless I get it, and then I take Coartem. Do I recommend that travellers take a prophylaxis? Absolutely. yes. And then there was another interesting question there about, do you acquire some local immunity? This is something I think scientifically people have been back and forth on quite a bit. The rumours that you hear are, yes, that over time you can build up an immunity to it. And there does seem to be some scientific evidence to this, that the longer you live in a malarial zone, the less likely you are to contract it. I don't know about that. I think it's probably true if you're a child who grows up here and gets it in childhood, that maybe you develop more immunity to it later in life. You know, people do say that you develop an immunity, but if you leave Rwanda and then come back, that you will have lost that immunity, that you lose the immunity very quickly. I'm not sure how helpful it is, because I mean, I didn't get my first bout of malaria till I'd been here for many years. So I don't know. I'm not sure how scientifically proven that is. I've read other papers that said, no, it's negligible. So I don't know. I mean, people do like to say that you've got a bit of immunity here. Don't know. Right, so the final part of this long waffle is I'm going to talk about how bad is it. I might need to go and get another cup of tea for this. All right, so I'm back. I've just had a bit of a think about it, and looking at how long this video is getting, I think I'm just going to give you a very brief overview. And if you're interested in the real nitty-gritty of having malaria and what that's like, let me know below, and I will maybe do a different video, a follow-up video, where I go into detail about my experiences. but really for this video, I think all you want to know is kind of roughly what it's like. If it is uncomplicated, which it is in most cases in well-fed, healthy individuals like myself, it is like having extreme flu. The build-up to it can be very, very different for different people. So there are a list of things to look out for. Headaches are a big one. Like, people can get headaches and they think it's dehydration, you know. I didn't get any headaches the first time around, but what I had, which you don't hear people talking about, is a really weird one, is I went from feeling full, as though I'd just eaten a big meal, to starving hungry in like the split second. It was really, really weird. Like, I don't know how to explain it. I'd just be going along and then boom, I was so hungry, I felt I have to eat now. And then when the food was in front of me, I felt like I don't really want to eat it. And it was really, really weird. I couldn't figure out what was going on until later on when the malaria presented itself, and I went, oh, all right, that was probably that. And then when that happened again, the second time I got it again, right, now I know what to look out for in myself. It's if I suddenly feel this incredible pang of hunger, but I don't want to put anything in my mouth and eat, that might be a warning sign. But it's not one that I've heard from many other people. So I think it can really affect people in very, very different ways. So some people don't get a headache, some people do get a headache. You can go about your normal business and not know that you've got it until bang, you know you've got it. And I don't think I know anybody who has had it and gone, oh, I'm not sure if I have malaria. You know, it's full on. So, you know, when you have the flu and you get like the shivers, you get the cold shivers and the sweats, it's that, but so intense. The shivers can feel like you're in the Antarctic naked in the snow. You know, you feel like you're never going to be warm again. You feel like you could die of cold. And then the sweats, you need to sleep on a towel because it is, you will soak through the mattress. It can be extreme, and you'll go through a cycle of that over a few hours. So you'll usually start with the freezing cold, and then you'll have the sweats, and you almost welcome the fever because it's better than the cold. You know, it's like, oh, thank God, at least I'm warm, you know. There's that, and it's extreme. And also for me, the intense muscle aches. Like, I think we've all had that really achy body feeling when you're coming down with flu or you're coming down with something nasty. I think COVID probably did it for a lot of people. You get that pain in your joints, and that for me can be extreme to the point where I'm rocking and humming. It sounds like a mental institute, but I'm rocking and humming to myself just to calm myself, to soothe myself, you know, until I get to the medication or wherever, you know, doctor, whatever I need to do. But if it's uncomplicated, so there are any other factors that are distorting you, you get your coartem. You often also get a course of antibiotics. Now, the antibiotics are there to make sure it doesn't go cerebral, because malaria gets dangerous when it enters your cerebral cortex and it affects the brain. That's a fast track to checking out. So they give you antibiotics as well to make sure that it doesn't spread or get anywhere that it shouldn't, and your coartem. And the thing about coartem is you have to take it at exactly the time intervals it tells you to. Do not be late on that. Take it exactly as instructed. Do not deviate from the instructions. But if you do that, within 3 days, you're going to start to feel a lot better, and the virus is dead and you're fine. Now, you're going to be a bit weak afterwards, like as with the flu or COVID, it might have gone, but you've had a bit of a shock to your body and your system, and you're going to take a few weeks to get back up to full strength again. That was my first experience of it, uncomplicated. I was really surprised how quickly the medication worked. Second time around, I wasn't quite as lucky. I might do another video and explain what happened with that one. But I thought I killed it, but the coartem hadn't been entirely effective. And what happened was, the rapid test for malaria isn't entirely effective. Is it can miss malaria several times. You need quite a high level of malaria in your blood for the rapid test to be absolutely accurate. And what had happened was, because I'd taken the coartem, it had reduced the level of malaria in my blood. I wasn't presenting with fever. The fever had stopped. And that's the one thing that people look for, that and the temperature is usually a good giveaway that you've got it. I hadn't really got any symptoms of malaria, but it was affecting my immune system, so I was getting secondary problems. I had incredible tonsillitis, like my whole throat was bright white. I developed a kidney infection, which got really bad. And I was just in a real bad state. My body was not coping, but they couldn't find it because there wasn't enough of it in my system and I wasn't presenting with standard malarial symptoms. So it went untreated for a month, and within that month my body and my mental health took an incredible knock. Eventually, I ended up being tested again because I've been through several tests and they weren't finding anything. I went through another test and eventually they found it. There was enough of it in my system. I finally got the fever, and there was enough of it in my system that they found it. And then again, slapped me with coartem, and I was fine after that. But when I say fine, it took me about 6 months to get back to full health, just because it had been untreated for a while. I have had a friend who also had, I think it's called black water malaria, which can be another complicated, a very nasty complication. So complications can happen. Cerebral malaria can happen. It can be bad. And yeah, you don't know. You don't know. I mean, still, it was bad, but for me, it was not so bad that I wouldn't risk it again. You know, I'm older now, I'm wiser now, I have a better understanding of what the complications could be, but still, I would rather just, you know, live my life without constant daily side effects from prophylactics. In the knowledge that if I do get it, the hospitals around here usually know what to do. And so, it, again, like I said, it's not an easy answer, and it's definitely not something anybody can tell you, you know, to take prophylaxis or to stop taking them, or it's absolutely your decision. But if you decide not to take them, you do need to know that there is a very real risk that you can get malaria, and sometimes it's bad. But again, I mean, it was bad, but I don't feel it was anything that I haven't fully recovered from, or I never really felt like I was in mortal danger. I just felt really bad, really rough. So yeah, anyway, that's my experience with it. please feel free to share your own experiences below. I might go into more of a deep dive about those two times that I had it, because they were vastly, vastly different experiences, of just having like standard run-of-the-mill malaria that was cured really quickly and having complications. And it was a very, very difficult time to go through. So yeah, I might go into that in another video, but I feel like I've rambled enough for this one. If you've got any more questions, please do drop them below. Again, like I say, I'm not a medical professional. I'm just somebody who's lived in a malaria zone for many years, and, you know, have observed it, have had it. Yeah, so if I can be helpful in that capacity, drop the questions below. If you'd like to share your story of having it, or, you know, what your thoughts are about which prophylaxis to go for and, you know, how to manage the risk, that would be great to put below. Oh, one other thing that I really, really should mention is that whether you take anything or you don't, 100% you should sleep under a mosquito net. I know a lot of people don't like to, because you can get cheap mosquito nets that are like a ring and they drape down, and people can feel very claustrophobic about that. What I would suggest if you're living here is definitely to get posts on your bed. So all of my beds have got like wooden posts around them, and over that I put a square mosquito net so I don't get tangled up in it at night. It's really easy to sleep under. But absolutely get that, because the mosquito that spreads malaria usually bites at night. Now, it has actually been proven, not always. People do have this myth that if you always sleep underneath a mosquito net, you can't possibly get malaria. That's not true. Apparently, a third of bites do happen during the daytime. That's recently been shown. So that myth about you can only get bitten by a malaria mosquito at night isn't true. So you can get it any time of the day, but statistically you are much more protected if you sleep underneath a decent mosquito net. So I would say, whether you take the pills or you don't, get yourself a decent mosquito net. If you're interested in learning a bit more about malaria, I really do recommend this book. It's called The Fever by Sonia Shah, and it's just a really I suppose it's a really fun read. Not exactly fun, but it's a really engaging and very personable read. Sonia Shah is British Indian, and if I recall, she first kind of really became interested in malaria when she was a child, and she went to visit her family in India and suddenly realized that they had to sleep under bed nets and take precautions, and she kind of wondered, you know, what is malaria and why does it affect certain countries? And she just fell down this rabbit hole, and it's fascinating because it really does look at the 500,000 years of history between the coexistence of human beings and malaria, and, you know, the effect it's had on shaping our world. It is fascinating. She's also done a TED talk, so I'll leave a link to that below as well. Okay, all right, bye bye.